what I wanted to discuss with you today, which is kind of the evolution in technology that we've seen in audiology over the years. And, you know, the last decade even has brought about so many big changes in what we can do with technology, our options. If you think back on that last decade, Dr. Pitrone, what's the most game-changing advancement, do you think, that we've seen?
I feel like the most game-changing advancements have been being able to understand patients' real-world function, both with hearing loss and tinnitus, and then adapt their technology and their treatment options to accommodate their individual capabilities, and then to adapt it to their lifestyles and their specific goals. Because, of course, what one person with hearing loss or tinnitus needs is very different than the right option for the next person. And you can't see that just based on an audiogram. So the deeper we can dig into the individual's processing function, their sound sensitivity or sound tolerance, the way that their tinnitus interacts with their entire auditory system and their auditory perception, if we can better understand that, we can then better adapt it or adapt their treatment to accommodate their unique needs. And I feel like that has been game changing in the last few years.
So two questions that you just brought up for me. Why is it so complex from person to person? Is there like a general reason why it's so complex in trying to figure out the right treatment options from person A to person B?
I think the way we process sound is as unique as our fingerprint. Everybody processes sound differently, and that comes from your biology. It comes from your life experience, your personality. It comes from the degree of injury in your auditory system. The reason for injury in the auditory system is significant. There are so many factors. Cognitive function is a major factor. So it's so difficult to just look at a simple hearing test and say, this is exactly what you need to feel improvement, because there are so many different layers to that. And unless you start peeling back those layers, you really don't have a good understanding of what an individual requires in treatment.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I like to tell patients, no two people have the same brains, right? And because each of us has our own unique brain, our own unique brain wiring system, we cannot really attempt to treat it successfully with a one-size-fits-all approach, just like you're saying. And, you know, you're so right. There's so many added layers of complexity, because processing sound is a very complex interconnected system in the brain with all sorts of different areas of our nervous system being attached to. So, yeah. When we talk about the technology being able to be better matched for all of those different layers of processing, what do we mean exactly? Because I think there's a common misconception that, well, a hearing aid, you should just be able to take it out of the box, put it on someone and let them go, and off on their way, they are experiencing benefit, right? What can we do today to help make that treatment more specific to the individual?
The biggest, most recent change is AI in hearing aids, and that hearing aids are now not only prescriptive, as they have been for quite a while, meaning the amplification is shaped to the individual's hearing loss, but AI allows that amplification to do so much more than just raise the volume. Because it would be great if that's all it was, raise the volume, problem solved. But because of those complexities and the way we process sound, it simply is not that easy. And the brain is very active in our ability to hear and comprehend in an uninjured ear. And so we have to utilize the AI in the hearing instruments to more accurately mimic what the human brain is doing, or get as close as we can, which is going to give the person a better end experience and better overall comprehension and audibility.
Right. And in terms of AI, I think the term deep neural network is being used a lot in conjunction with AI. And I don't know that a lot of people really understand maybe what that means and why that's important. But kind of what you're alluding to, what I'm hearing you say, Dr. Pitrone, is that AI is helping us better mimic the brain, probably, wouldn't you agree, more so too in complex listening environments where there's multiple sources of sound, multiple people talking, background noise? Because how many patients come in and tell us every day, right? Like, I hear you fine one-on-one. I must not have much of a problem. It's like, well, no, one-on-one and quiet, right? Everybody can compensate. I've seen people with severe hearing loss compensate quite well because we speak very clearly. We've been trained to articulate all of our speech, right? But the AI and these deep neural networks, what are they really doing, do you think? Or do you have an understanding of what they might be doing to help people in complex noise? What's the strategy there with, you know, restaurants, for instance?
Right. Yeah. And restaurants being one of the most common places that people struggle as they're trying to engage with their loved ones. The strategy behind AI and the deep neural network is to understand the listening environment. So it is not as simple as just finding speech. We need to find speech. We need to find that with directional cues and directional information. Is that speech in front of me? Is it beside me? Is it close? Is it far away? Am I moving? Is the speech that I'm listening to moving? When there's competing speech, like in a restaurant, that device needs to be able to identify which source of speech is the most significant source, because they're not all important in that listening environment. And the brain does that by anticipating. We know what our brain, we kind of have an idea of what's coming next. So if we're in a restaurant, we're getting ready to leave, we're wrapping up the meal, we kind of know we're going to stand up, we're going to look around, we're going to start moving. Our hearing device has to be able to anticipate those changes and ideally anticipate them before they occur. So the AI and the deep neural network is consistently sampling the environment around you, cueing the hearing aid into those little nuances in the environment that are so much more precise than just the spectral information, just the sound information. And when we can have a more comprehensive understanding of the entire environment, the hearing aid can anticipate our listening needs before they happen. It can adapt the amplification and very, very, very quickly. And that more closely mimics the way that an ear and a brain would process that sound organically.
Right. And I think what you're also saying is that we take for granted that an undamaged system does all of these things naturally.
Yes.
But a damaged system, let's say someone has had a very slowly progressive hearing loss over 5+ years. I mean, I think the average age or the average duration of hearing loss before treatment is still something like 7 years for our patients before they seek treatment. So I think people forget that if you've slowly had hearing loss over 7 years, this type of processing doesn't just automatically reset when you get a prescriptive hearing device with AI and a deep neural network. The technology is fantastic and amazing, but it also requires some time, right? Some adapting to the new signals, time for the brain to remember how to process all of the different complex signals that it's receiving. So how do you usually counsel your patients when they're excited about AI, they're excited about the new technology, excited about, you know, I heard this has a deep neural network. That's amazing, because that's a really, you know, great thing with computer technology in general. But how do you counsel for realistic expectations with using this technology? What do you typically tell patients?
So first is helping people understand the integrity of their auditory system. And I like to think of our ear as a freeway. Sound has to get from the outside world to our brain. So when that system is not damaged, it's that nice, wide, 6-lane freeway, the road's nice and smooth, bright sunny day, there's room for us all to spread out, and traffic is just flowing easily. And then as hearing loss develops, we lose a lane and we get a pothole, and now there's debris in the road and there's a traffic jam, and we're trying to take that 6 lanes worth of traffic or 6 lanes worth of sound information, and we are now trying to funnel that into 1 or 2 lanes where that road isn't even in the best shape that it used to be in. We don't just fix that overnight. We can't bring that all the way back to that nice, clean, brand new freeway. We can work on it. So we have to, the earlier we intervene, the better it's going to be, because we can stop some of that progression before it starts. And then we can use the technology to help shape and modify sound so that it can travel more successfully down that injured road. And that's really the purpose of AI, is to take that big wide world of sound, clean it up, find the pieces we care about, and then package it into a bundle that can still travel through that injured system to get it to the brain so that the person is then able to access and benefit from that sound.
Yeah, I love that analogy. Yeah, it is. It's kind of like, how do we get from point A to point B when the pathway is no longer as intact or as clean as it used to be? Yeah, that's a challenge. That's for sure.
Easier said than done sometimes, but technology is getting better and better and making that more and more successful.